Hey, welcome back to the channel. So if you're anything like me, you've read about Chromebooks and wondered why people are buying these things. I mean, just running Chrome OS, they seem like they can only be used online and they're totally limited what you can do with it, right? Well, I thought the same thing until I got this Dell Inspiron Chromebook 14 the other day. I've been using this for like 2 weeks now and have totally changed my tune. So I hope to provide some information and help answer that question when people ask why get a Chromebook. So the things I show you in this video are not going to be specific to this Chromebook, but they are going to be specific to certain capabilities of a Chromebook. So the Chromebook that you're looking at, make sure that it can run Linux applications and Android applications. If it can do those two things, you'll be able to use just about everything I show you in this video just out of the box without any tweaking. Now, if you're somebody that likes to tweak a little bit more and don't mind doing a little more configuration, there's another method that I'm gonna show you at the end of this video that's a little more advanced that gives you a lot more capabilities as far as application availability. If you have any suggestions on things I didn't cover here or have any questions, leave those down in the comment section below. And with all that out of the way, let's get into some of the reasons why you would want to get a Chromebook. So some of the things that finally made me decide to get a Chromebook are the simplicity of the operating system. It's super fast. It starts up super fast. The updates are completely painless and everything just launches really, really quickly. It runs great even on really modest hardware. The battery life on most Chromebooks are amazing. I haven't had to charge this in about 3 days now. It's very, very battery efficient. And again, it's because the operating system is so efficient and can run on really battery efficient hardware as well. Now on the hardware side, you can get something for $150 that's made out of plastic that runs Chrome OS fantastically well, but is super cheap if you just need something to get stuff done, all the way up to the Pixelbook that's over $1,000 with some great hardware, touchscreen, stylus, all that good stuff, and everything in between. So the nice thing is that there is a broad range of devices and it's really easy to find one that meets the capabilities you're looking for at the price point you're looking for. All right, so let's talk about the elephant in the room. And in my mind, that is the limited storage on Chromebooks. Now, most of them come with 32 or 64 gigs of storage. This one that I got has a 128 gigs of storage, and some of the higher end ones also have 128. I shied away from the 32 or 64 gigabytes of storage because I like to tweak my devices and push them to their limits and see what I could do. And I knew I would need that extra storage for some of the stuff I wanted to do. That's not gonna be the case for everybody. Some people are gonna be fine with either 32 or 64 gigs of storage if they're using it at the basic level, because most of the storage, they strongly encourage you to store that in Google Drive. There is a way to store stuff locally. Depending on your needs, don't necessarily shy away from that 32 or 64 gigs of storage, because if you're just gonna be storing everything in the cloud anyway, it doesn't really matter. So one thing I love about these devices, and something that's going away in a lot of other devices, is the availability of the ports. For instance, this one has two USB-C, a USB-A SD card reader, and a headphone jack. Now, those USB-C ports are for charging or USB-C devices. They're not Thunderbolt devices, but you can use, you know, your hubs to expand the ports, little USB-C adapters, whatever you want to use. I've used an adapter that provides two more USB 3.0 ports and an HDMI port. I put it out to an HDMI monitor. It just recognizes it. Everything I've hooked up to this device, it's just recognized it. It's just worked. I haven't had to load any drivers or anything. That has been fantastic. I've had to mess with this machine so much less than any Mac, Linux-based computer or Windows-based computer that I've ever used. So the day-to-day use on these machines, even on the lower end, is completely smooth. I mean, it was built for that kind of stuff, for browsing the web, checking your email, you know, doing some word processing and things like that. Everything just flies. The machine starts up super quick. Applications launch really fast. And even on the devices with like 2 gigs of RAM, multitasking is not really an issue because these are really small, efficient apps that run on these. Now, if you're going to be doing some of the more advanced stuff that I'm going to show you later, you're going to want something with a little bit more than those 2 gigs. This one has 4 gigs and everything runs really, really well on it. I have not had any problem with responsiveness. And talking about responsiveness, the touchscreen on these things is great. This one is phenomenal, but even the lower end ones, I've not had an issue with touchscreen responsiveness or input, you know, missing my swipe gestures or tapping or anything like that. Like I said, even on the lower end devices that support a touchscreen. So that has been a fantastic experience. Now, one common misconception I hear is that you have to be connected to the internet to use a Chromebook. And that is just not the case. There are many, many Chrome applications that work in an offline mode, especially the Google ones. The Google Office Suite and Google Drive allows you to set some files to be available offline. So if you're going on a trip, you can just set those files to be available offline, edit them while you're on the plane or in the car or whatever. And then when you connect to the internet again, it'll just sync everything up. And then with the Linux apps and the Android apps, that's especially true because a lot of those were built to be used in kind of an offline mode. So your options are open up there, and I'll get to that in just a minute. All right, so in talking about applications, what are some of the options for applications? Well, the first one is any web-based app, of course, is going to work. Any website, because this thing is built on Chrome OS. Likewise, any web application from the Chrome Web Store is going to work. And a lot of those will just install in the OS. And then when you go to the app drawer, they'll show up just like any other application. Now, the next two things, this is kind of where I mentioned before that you're going to have to check the capabilities of your Chromebook, because the next two options are native Android apps and native Linux apps. Now with the Android apps, you can install the Google Play Store, or actually it installs it for you, and then you can go out to the Play Store and install apps and games till your heart's content. Everything that I've tried installed through the Play Store works great, and you can use it in just kind of a windowed mode that simulates a phone screen, or a lot of them you can go full screen and use them as full screen apps as well. Now the last thing is native Linux apps, and this has been integrated into Chrome OS as well on a lot of machines. It's basically just toggling another option in the settings, and then you can, through a command line, install Linux applications. I have installed GIMP. The image editor, I use that all the time. I needed it on this machine. It installed no problem and works really well. Have no issue using it on this Chromebook. The only limitations to that method are there is no GPU, so no graphics card acceleration, and no audio. So things like video editors, audio editors, things like that are not going to work because that's not available yet. But that capability is coming soon, so keep a lookout for that. So another thing this thing excels is with media consumption. So of course you can get to all the websites, YouTube, Hulu, Netflix, but there are some dedicated Chrome apps for those things. And also there's options of installing the Android app for those services and many, many other services too. And the screen on a lot of these machines is great. The screen on this Inspiron is beautiful. Media looks fantastic on this. If media consumption is a primary use for you, you may want to consider that when you're buying a device. Some of those lower end machines have not very good screens. So just keep that in mind if that's something that you're looking for. And another great thing about these machines is it's really easy to share that media up to a larger screen. You can either hook up a monitor directly to the device, or you can Chromecast directly from Chrome OS to any Chromecast device. I've tried it to a physical, you know, standalone Chromecast device and an NVIDIA Shield TV box. And in both cases, it worked great. No real setup or anything. I just chose the device from my list and streamed it over, and it worked just no problem at all. All right, so you know, whenever I review a device, I gotta have a gaming section, and today is no different. And there actually are some options for gaming on these devices. Now, the first one is installing games from the Chrome Web Store. These are built specifically for Chrome Web Browser or Chrome OS, so of course they work great. Now, a lot of those games are pretty limited, so you know, just keep that in mind, but a lot of them are very fun as well. Now, the better option probably is installing from the Android Play Store, and those Android apps and games work great. Like I mentioned before, I've installed a bunch of games and they work really, really well. The only caveat is that most of those games are not designed for either a controller or keyboard and mouse. So you're going to need to make sure that you have a device with a touchscreen if gaming with those Android apps is going to be important to you. Now, the next two options I want to talk about are both streaming options. The first one is streaming within your local network with the Steam Link app that's available in the Android Play Store. That uses the Steam in-home streaming, where you connect to a gaming machine that's on your network and stream all your games to the Chromebook. Now, the benefit of that is that you're on your local network. If you have a fast connection, there's very low latency, and in most cases, you can use the keyboard and mouse and a controller. I've hooked an Xbox 360 controller, a wired one, up to this, and I didn't have to load any drivers or anything. It just detected it. It just worked again out of the box. Didn't have to mess with it, and it was a great experience. Now, this next streaming thing is cloud streaming services, and everybody and their mother is making these now, so I'm not going to go into any specifics. Caveat to that is that you're going to need a very, very fast, reliable internet connection. So you're really only going to be able to use that at home if you're at, you know, an airport or at a hotel Wi-Fi. It's probably not going to be good enough to play those games. So the last area I wanted to talk about before I get into that advanced stuff is with media creation. Now, you may not think of a Chromebook as a media creation tool, but there actually are some options. If you're an artist and you have a Chromebook with a stylus, Artflow and Autodesk Sketchbook are two great options. There's a bunch of other great options out there. Most of the Chromebooks with a stylus are pressure sensitive, so you get that pressure sensitivity. You get really good response with the stylus, and those are great options. If you want to edit audio, there's some audio editors, and there's actually some DAWs out there, some digital audio workstations. Three great ones are StageLite, Audio Evolution Mobile, and FL Studio Mobile. Those all work really well and give you some really good DAW capabilities on your Chromebook, which I was a little bit surprised by. For image editing, there's a lot of great options available in the Google Play Store. There's Pixlr, there's Photoshop Express, there's a whole bunch of options available. And then there's also, with the integrated Linux capabilities, there's the capability of loading any Linux-based image editors, and that's why I installed GIMP. I've been using GIMP for years. That's my image editor of choice, and it works great on this, installing it through Linux. So last thing is video editing, and there are some video editing capabilities of a Chromebook. Now, there's some options for online video editing. There's a real popular one called WeVideo. You can edit up to 4K video. What you do is you upload your media to there and then edit it basically in a browser-based editor. That editor is actually really feature-rich. It's actually a pretty good experience if you don't mind using that online connection for your editing. For offline editing, there's some options available in the Android Play Store, and two big ones are KineMaster and PowerDirector. Those both work very, very well. With this Inspiron, I was only able to edit 1080p video in both of those applications, so 4K was not an option. And they're both pretty decent basic editors. You can do a basic video as long as you're not doing anything too advanced and just get the job done with these. In a pinch, they actually work really well. If you're only working with 1080p video and you're just splicing clips and maybe doing transition between them, these are really viable options. Now, there is another much more powerful option for video editing that I'm going to talk about in the next section when I get into some of those advanced configurations that I mentioned earlier in the video. So here we are at that advanced section that I mentioned earlier in the video. Now, this section requires a little more tweaking, and you're going to have to put your device into the developer mode, but it's going to open up options to more gaming, more media creation, video editing, audio editing, development, all kinds of stuff. It's going to vastly just blow the roof off the capabilities of your Chromebook. So if you don't mind tweaking and you don't mind putting your machine into developer mode, you can install something called Crouton. Now, Crouton is basically a full-on Linux distribution. Right now, it's based on Ubuntu 16.04, and it's a little bit different than the integrated Linux that's built into Chrome OS. Now, with that one, you can use it within Chrome OS, and it puts a shortcut just like any other application, but again, the limitations are GPU acceleration and sound. Now, with Crouton, it's basically doing a full Linux installation that after it's set up, you can just launch it from a command prompt and you're launched into a full Linux desktop. From there, you can install Steam and install Steam games. You can install basically anything that runs on Linux that's going to run well on the hardware that you have, you can install inside of this distribution of Linux. Now, I've tried a bunch of games in Steam, and obviously the ones that are GPU intensive are not going to work well because at least my machine doesn't have a dedicated graphics card in it. But things like RimWorld or Oxygen Not Included, things along that nature run great on this machine. I've tried other editing tools. And the thing that I wanted to mention, that I wanted to really focus on, is the video editor. Now, there is a Linux-based video editor called Kden Live. And you can install this inside this installation of Crouton, and then you can edit your 1080p videos, 4K videos. It has way, way more capabilities than the options that I mentioned that are available in the Android Play Store, KineMaster, or PowerDirector. You can do much more advanced edits in here, color correction, everything you would expect in a video editor. Kden Live is free. I've used this on my Linux systems for years, and it runs really well on my machine in this Linux distribution. Now, with all those other capabilities, there are some trade-offs. You're going to need to put your machine into developer mode. You're going to need to do the setup for Crouton. You need to learn how to install Linux apps. All that is actually really easy, and I'm happy to do a tutorial on it. Just let me know down below, and I can make that one of my Tutorial Tuesday videos. The other thing is there's probably going to be a little more hit on that battery life because Linux is not quite as battery efficient as Chrome OS is, so that'll burn through that a little bit faster if you're going to be using Linux a lot. But for me, those trade-offs are well worth the additional capabilities that I got by setting this up, and I'll leave that up to you to decide. Like I said, everything that I talked about in the video up to this point is available without having to do this additional tweaking. This is just if you want those additional capabilities. Hopefully that was enough information to help answer that question, why use a Chromebook? I know for me, in about the space of about a week, I went from not even understanding why these things even exist to absolutely loving it. And this being the machine that I take with me when I'm going on the road, I leave the much more powerful but much heavier and bulkier gaming machine that I used to take with me, that has stayed home, and this is the machine that I take on the road with me now. Hopefully you found this useful and informative. Please hit that thumbs up if you did. If you really liked it, hit that subscribe button. Again, if you want me to do that tutorial on how to install Chrome, let me know down below, and I will see you in the next video. Thanks for stopping by.